Welcome to CFRI's Cystic Fibrosis Community Voices, a video podcast series created by and for the cystic fibrosis community.
Is it on?
Clap twice.
I have number two.
Everyone clap in the count of three and it'll work.
Emily, you're number three.
One, two, three.
Okay, well, thank you. Good evening, everybody. I'm Jerry. This is Em. This is the JEM show. We're going to start off with a little video we put together recently.
This morning. It's still in production. What's up? I'm Em.
And I have cystic fibrosis.
I've got CF2.
Oh, and I had a double lung transplant 7 years ago. And we are the Jerry and Em show.
Or JEM. We're biking to breathe.
Biking to breathe this year up through the Rockies, Montana, and all around. And we just like to have lots of fun.
Laugh a lot, dance a lot.
Oh, we dance. Yeah, we do dance. And we exercise for life.
Exercise for life.
And we just
rock
life. Life is great.
Help with cystic fibrosis is always challenges and things that I had to overcome. I was told I'm lucky if I make it to my 16th birthday. And to me, that was a challenge. I had to move forward, create new goals for myself, and reinvent myself. And in doing so, I started volunteering at the Boomer Esiason Foundation. Get a little bit more involved in coaching. I coach high school pole vaulters, and I also was reinventing what I do with exercise and doing a lot more training.
First 18 months of my life, I was semi-healthy, but a lot of chronic ear infections and digestive issues. My parents knew something wasn't right from the get-go. I was an active kid, active teen, but early 20s playing in the band. No time to exercise, you know, do my treatments, but no time to really go beyond. In 2007, I founded the Rock CF Foundation. We were putting on these concerts called Just Let Me Breathe, all to raise money for Rock CF and CF research. I started looking at exercise as more of a form of treatment. I kind of fell in love with exercise. It's great. Now it's just a part of what I do and who I am. I'm just a whole new person since I started biking and running, and it's awesome. Doesn't matter if you ride 500 miles, or you ride 5 blocks, or you walk, or you run, or you jump on a trampoline, just do something to get the airways going. Let's face it, exercise is good for everybody. So if I can do it, and my other friends with CF and other illnesses can do it, so can anyone else.
So we are trying to bring awareness to the importance of exercise, whether it's running or biking. We want people to bike to breathe because it's really important as a form of therapy to keep your lungs clear.
My life is not about CF. It's about me as an individual being strong-minded, strong-willed, and pushing through.
Okay, well, that's just a little intro on Em and I. And we have a PowerPoint, so we're going to go through that. I'm going to let Em lead off with the PowerPoint.
Have you guys seen the show Between Two Ferns with Zach Galifianakis? It's kind of what I feel like right now. I'm moving over here. Yeah. Jerry's actually 63, by the way, not 62.
Yeah, I'm 63.
We just rode 100 miles on his 63rd birthday.
But I feel like I'm 18.
Yeah. He's the youngest looking 63-year-old in America. So we're going to chart the course together. I'll give you a little background of my life, and then Jerry will share his, and then we'll do some Q&A and just see how you guys are doing. It's fun to be here. I feel like this is past my bedtime because I'm from Detroit, and I'm usually 2 hours in here. So bear with me. I was born in 1982. Awesome year to be born. And when my mom and dad... held me for the first time, especially my mom, she knew something wasn't quite right. So I have two older brothers who don't have CF, super healthy kids. This is 1982 at the time. I'm 6 pounds, 10 ounces. Not a big baby, but not super small. But my mom just knew something wasn't quite right. And we're still trying to figure everything out. I think we got a long way to go. But she just had this mother's intuition. And the more parents of CF people that I talk to, now we have newborn screening, right? But a lot of these people just knew something wasn't quite right. And my parents thought they were crazy, but they just knew something was wrong. But they sent me home, said she's fine, she's adorable. The bowl cut, I was born with that bowl cut.
Nice haircut.
I'm growing it back. We should do it for Bike to Breathe. We're going to have bowl cuts in September, both of us. So diagnosed finally at 18 months after one failed sweat test. Actually, one not failed because they said I didn't have CF. Then after the second sweat test, they said, yeah, she has CF. Take her home, love her, enjoy her, but she probably won't live long enough to graduate from high school. Because that's what they were seeing at the time in Detroit at Children's Hospital. Kids weren't living into their teens and adulthood, right? And, I mean, I've known my parents 37 years because I outlived that prognosis there. But when we talk, especially lately, I'm trying to talk to them and get to the root of how they actually felt upon that diagnosis. And I've talked to other parents, probably a few of you guys here, about when your child was diagnosed or when you were diagnosed. But for them, they took it really hard, like that first, they say a week, which I find it hard to believe, but they like cried together for a week, and then they decided like, okay, we're actually going to let her be like her brothers. I was a tomboy, surprise. But they wouldn't treat me different from any other kid or my brothers. So signed me up for T-ball. I always bring this up, that kid's picking his wedgie, the first baseman. And then I would be outside as soon as the sun came up in the morning. And Jerry was the same way, I think. Sun's up, you're outside, you're running around, you're playing. Sun goes down, my mom whistles. You hear the whistle, you have to be home within minutes or else you're busted. But that's how they let me go. They're like, I'm playing in mud. I didn't put that picture in, but there's pictures of me in a bathing suit sliding down mud piles. And now parents are like, don't even let your kid look at mud because you might get some weird bacteria. So times have changed. The 90s and 80s were not a... It was an amazing time to have and live with CF because we had CF camps and we got to really enjoy life without knowing really what we were doing to ourselves. But my parents made me do chores just like everyone else. And in this picture, I'm crying because I wanted to wash the dishes, but I got stuck on drying duty. So really typical childhood. So upon diagnosis in 83, there were no treatments, right? There were vitamin A, D, E and K and enzymes, and then my parents were told they would have to beat me, which, I mean, they probably got a little thrill out of that, but we did chest physical therapy like 2 or 3 times a day, right? My mom would whistle if I was outside. That was her thing, this giant whistle. Not a real one, but she uses her hands. And I would come in, and they would do chest PT. So my dad is 6'7", big guy, actually shrunk an inch. You know guys shrink when you get older? Now he's like 6'5". I'll still say 6'7". So his routine with me is he would lay me down where my head would hit his toes, and then he would just pound me, and he's a giant. So he has, like, giant bear hands. And very gentle man, very gentle soul, and he would teach me, like, paradiddles. He was a music instructor and a musician. So that's kind of how I got into music was my dad, but he would teach me drum beats, and we would sing songs. Then when it was my mom's turn, she was a heavy hitter. She's about my size, but she was an athlete. And she's got that whip in her, not like a real whip, but she's got a whip to her hand. And I would always see if she took her rings off and put her rings on top of the dresser. Like, you know the routine, right? And every time I'd just make sure they took the rings off because if they left them on, I knew I was being a little jerk that day. So, but it was a good way to bond. Now parents just put their kids nebulizer in their mouth. They throw them on a vest, give them an iPad and say, see you in 30. But... is that true? I think it's true. You guys know? Yeah. Okay. See? Right? So I had this great time to bond with my parents for the first 12 years of my life. I think it was better for them than me, but... and then the vest came out and things kind of progressed. So enzymes were started right away, and I started to actually gain weight and thrive. My parents were beating me. I was taking vitamins, and then I lived like these first 12 or 13 years of my life with just that, right? This was before things started coming out, and 93 Pulmozyme came out. It was like the first inhaled medication that I had. And I'm like, wow. Okay, so I would go to the hospital for a checkup every 2 to 3 months and get weighed, do a pulmonary function test. But I didn't really connect what CF was, right, until I was running on the playground in third grade and I started coughing. And I'm like, oh, cough. Maybe this is something that I'm going to do forever. And I did. Like, that was the first time I recognized CF, put two and two together. That's why I go to the hospital for all these tests. And I'm going to be coughing for the rest of my life, which is what happens with CF. Then these other drugs start coming out. I was on Toby, the trial, and Case, and all these things. And our toolbox started growing. So the burden of care for CF in the 80s and 90s was a lot of chest therapy and enzymes, but not like what we have today, right? It takes a lot of time and effort. So super healthy kid, exercising. I think Jerry might talk about exercise a little bit. You're kind of why I started exercising. I'll get into that, but I don't want to flatter you too much. So first exacerbation was middle school, and I'm like, oh man, this could be it. Like, this is what's going to happen. And sure as heck, it went the first time in seventh grade, then twice in eighth grade, and 2 to 3 times in high school, and going to prom and having my reception in my hospital room at Children's Hospital with sparkling wine, and going to every holiday in the hospital. And like, just, it started to kind of freak me out a little bit, and I never really talked about it until recently, really, like the mental toll that a chronic disease like CF takes on you. And I'm glad we're finally talking about it as a community and how important it is. But my parents never recognized it. I never recognized it. I just hid it and smiled, because that's the easiest thing to do with life is smile. But got to high school, and I'm like, I'm going to move to New York and work on Broadway. I love theater. I'm a big theater dork. I just live there and see how long I last, right? Like, that was my, I didn't outwardly say that, but I, in my head, that's what was going to happen. So I decided to stay back in Detroit after talking to some people and, like, scaring myself. Like, maybe I shouldn't move to New York. Maybe I should stay with my family and hang out with them, because I'm not sure how long I'm going to be around. My lung function at the time was going into the 50s, and I'm just in the hospital a lot and scared. But, again, I just smiled and said, everything's fine. That's the name of my book, though, by the way. Everything's fine. Jerry, you can help me write that. But so I stayed in Detroit, studied theater for a couple years, and then I dropped out of school. And my parents were super pumped because they're both teachers. So when I'm like, guys, I'm dropping out of college, they're like, well, this is great. We're very proud of you, Emily. So I started working retail and making like $7 or $8 an hour, and moved out on my own, living with my brother downtown in Detroit. He was in a rock band. I started playing in a rock band. Playing drums in a smoky bar from like 7 p.m. to 2 a.m. is not good for people with CF, but I was living my life like there was no tomorrow and not doing my treatments like I should have been doing, even though I was saying, yeah, I'm doing my treatments. So yeah, it really took about a decade to lose control, to realize that I was out of control and figure out what the hell am I going to do to get back in control, right? And it comes to MySpace when I came across this old man, Jerry Cahill. And I'm perusing MySpace, which they just deleted all of our profiles. Did you guys know that? Yeah. Check it. We'll do a thing after. We'll do like a small group session. Maybe it's counseling. Maybe it's trying to retrieve your MySpace. But I'm looking on MySpace. I'm like, who's this old guy with CF who's still alive? And it's Jerry. And I'm like, holy cow, who is this guy? So I started researching him like way back, like MySpace time. And I'm like, this guy's exercising. And he was like a college pole vaulter, and he's old. He, at the time, you were like 40-something. It's fine.
Thanks, Em.
I know. I'll get there. I'll get there one day. But so after like seeing Jerry's inspiring story and then starting to connect with others on social media back in the early 2000s, and then having this realization, like, I am sick of being sick. There's got to be something more I can do. I'm in the hospital 3 to 4 times a year just watching my health decline. But I made it okay. I made it a cycle. So it's like I was stuck in this cycle of being okay with being sick. And then I decided I'm sick of that. That's BS. What can I do? And that was where I began my exercise journey of thinking I'm going to go out and run 2 miles. But making it half a block and like bending over and coughing and spitting everywhere and thinking like a little bit harder than I thought. This is not okay. I just didn't know what I was doing. I'd been the couch potato for the past 10 years plus. Drums was my only form of exercise. But as I got to that half block, then I made it to a block. Then I made it to 2 blocks. Then a mile, then 2 miles. And I just saw my lung function shoot up from like 50s to 70s. And the only thing I was doing was exercising. It was running. I started cycling at the time, doing some bike rides from Detroit to Chicago. And at the time, started the Roxy F Foundation. And today, I'm running marathons, biking with this fool all over the country and the world. I mean, it's endearing. Term of endearment, my buddy. But yeah, so Roxy F, once I finally, we started out with rock and roll concerts to get people together to raise funds and awareness for CF through music, because music is vital for everybody. For people with CF, it's especially awesome, especially a wind instrument or drums, because it gets you breathing hard. So we did a lot of concerts, but then when I realized playing drums in a smoky bar wasn't great, and I started running, we kind of shifted the vision of Roxy F to more empowering and exercise focused. So we do a big half marathon in Michigan. We have a program called Kicks Back, where we donate running shoes to people with CF to either get them off that couch, like I had to get off, I needed a little motivation. So either get somebody off the couch to walk their first block or mile, or give somebody their fifth pair of running shoes of the year so they can continue to run marathons. So we have people that span all over the spectrum, from 6-year-old kids to 70-year-olds with CF who are motivated to exercise, and we help them do that. So it's awesome. It's so fun to be able to do what I love, connect with Jerry and connect with all you guys. And yeah, we're rocking CF. And this is my buddy. Did you guys know he was a model too?
Okay, well, I'll tell you a little bit about me, the old man here. So I was diagnosed late with cystic fibrosis. I was diagnosed at 10 or 11. But since I'm old, I'm getting senile. It was one or the other.
I
was diagnosed, the doctors told my parents, you're lucky if your son makes it till his 16th birthday. So just keep him comfortable on the couch. And do we have another click?
I got it.
Oh, yeah, so there I am. Oh, so I was diagnosed at 11, and I'm 7 years post-transplant. The doctors told my parents, you're lucky if your son makes it till his 16th birthday. My mom wanted to put me in a bubble, take care of me, sit me on the couch, do nothing. My father was very athletic. I have 3 older brothers, very athletic. I have a younger brother and 1 sister, there's 6 of us. So, but when I was diagnosed, my father said, well, not to me, but if Jerry's not going to be around very long, he wants me to spend time with my brothers. My brothers all played sports. So I was thrown into sports, and instead of being like on the little peewee league, he made me play with my brothers that were 2, 3, and 4 years older than me. So I was like thrown into sports. We started with baseball. I didn't play ever. I played right field. I hated the game. I hated to get up at bat. All I would hope for was a walk. That season ended great. I got hit in the eye with a baseball. It was not a softball, baseball. I ended up in the emergency room with my mother, my father, my grandparents, and I kept saying, I don't want to play this game anymore. My father said, don't worry, finish out the season. We then went to football. My brother played in this league with Newt Rockne, besides playing in high school, and he was a halfback. He scored tons of touchdowns. Again, I would go play. I had the cleanest uniform. My father knew every coach really well, but in practice, I never was really hit. They just pushed me, but I knew the plays inside out. So we'd go to a game. My father would show up on the hill. We had a German Shepherd, Heidi, and I would just watch my father. I would go furthest away from the coach at the end of the bench, and I would just watch my brother scoring touchdowns, and I'd pray that he just stopped scoring touchdowns. My father would give this a little nod, right? Which meant put Jerry in because the team's winning by 30 points. The coach would say, Cahill, I'd ignore him. I was down the edge of the bat, Cahill, come here, you're going in for your brother. I'd ignore him. So my brother, then I'd have to go in, and my brother says, coming up, he goes, you better do a good job. I'm like, oh God, this is great. So I went in, and I was a halfback. So the first play I remember, the ball came to me and I had to run through the hole, and I got crushed. I was like, wow, this isn't what we do in practice. So then the next play, because my father's there, the ball comes to me. I had to go around the outside. I get the ball, and it's supposed to be running that way, and I'm running almost the wrong way on the other side. I run out of bounds. And all I did was look up at my father. My father's up there laughing. right? Like, thought this was hysterical. Oh, this is great, Jerry, great. But unbeknownst to everybody at the time, this was the best thing for me with CF because I was coughing and clearing up my lungs. We then went, I told my father I want to play this game anymore. We went to basketball. Now, basketball was a little more tame. I'd run up and down the court. I was terrible. And I'd do this, you know, with the ball, you throw it that way. I'd
score. That's how they did it in the old days.
One basket. But I thought I was great. So, and again, I didn't think of CF. I went to high school. I said, I'm a basketball player. I'm going to try out for the basketball. I was little. And you try out, and then you go look on the board if your name is not there. The first day, the next day I show up, and I'm looking at the board, and there's these guys. And I'm like, I don't see my name up there. He goes, if your name's not up there, you didn't make the team. You're not on the team. So I was like, oh. So I went to cross country. Now, here I am, this stupid CFer, going to run cross country. So nobody, you know, I guess back then, it's probably still the same. The people that run cross country, you're either a very good runner, or you didn't make any other team, or you're a geek that you just want to have stuff on your resume because you're thinking of college already. So I kind of fell into, not the geek, I don't want to say I was the geek, but we'd go out and run and walk and run and walk, and I was with that geek group. They talk about the homework assignments, all of this stuff. And then we say, oh, we better start running, but I would be coughing. They say, what's wrong with you? Oh, I've got asthma. It's like bronchitis. Oh, okay. They didn't care. So anyway, from there, I went into pole vaulting. I love pole vaulting. Did quite well. I was never hospitalized because of the power of exercise. I went to college, graduated college, started working, and I became that weekend warrior because I was working. I was an A++ personality. That I was working till 7, 8, 9, 10 o'clock at night, and I worked in the fashion industry, in the apparel, so it was nuts. I ended up getting sick for the first time, like on like IV stuff. I remember the doctor telling me, Jerry, I think it's time, because the Cipros and the pills, the Bactrims, they're not working. You have to go in the hospital. I'm like, what am I going to do? Oh, it's great. It's a tune-up. It's like a clean-out. It's like a tune-up. So I remember going into the hospital. Let me tell you, it was like one flew over the cuckoo's nest. I was put in the room. Now, they didn't have regular IVs. It was a little metal butterfly. I was in the room by myself the first night. The thing was swollen up. The doctor comes in the morning and it's like, oh, it's infiltrated. We have to fix it, blah, blah, blah. But in the interim, there's people kept coming into the room, would walk into my room, and they'd wave to me or smile and walk out. These were like parents. And I said to the doctor, why do these people keep coming into my room? He goes, oh, Jerry, don't worry about those. They're parents of people with CF. They've never seen somebody as old as you. I mean, I was 21. And I was like, wow, this is nuts, right? The kids in the hospital back then were 10 years old. They would yell at the nurses, leave the room, I'll do the IV myself. They were experts at putting in their own IVs. And then we roomed together then. They would bang on us through postural drainage. It was a cuckoo's nest. And then I remember I had a roommate, and he would look at me like I was like some kind of a god, and he was really pretty sick. And I couldn't be in the room, so I say, listen, just tell the nurses I'm in the bathroom. He goes, where are you going? I said, I'm going out. I can't stay in here. And I go out. So we ended up, I would get passes to go out. It was really a different world back then. It was growing up with CF in the dark ages. We didn't have pills. I took powdered enzymes. I'd hold my nose, put them in some juice, and drink it. My nebulizer was a Develbis little bulb. I'd push it, and I'd put mucomist in it, and you get a little flicker of mist, and that's what your therapy was. So the only thing I think that kept me alive was really all the exercise. I went to high school. I ran track. College, I pole vaulted. I got out of college. I said I was working. And then CF just started to progress. I worked in the apparel industry for, where am I on this little list here?
Oh,
yeah. Okay, yeah, 27 years old, pole vaulted, blah, blah, blah. I was an athlete. I went to UConn, Bachelor of Science, Psychology. Thanks, Em. Click away, I'm just rambling here. Anyway, I did really well, but it got to the point my CF progressed. My lung function was going down, 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 down. And then they told me that, well, you're going to be listed for a transplant. I told them there's no way that's not going to happen or whatever. But it ended up happening. But I was still doing and traveling and doing everything that I always was doing. I would travel with my little circus of IVs, those little, I call them baby bottles. stick them in my shirt. I'd be making presentations to people, going through airports. It was nuts, okay? I was just like driven, did really well in business. I was a vice president of sales. I was being promoted to senior vice president, and I had to leave. So anyway, I ended up going to the Boomer Esiason Foundation because I had to go out on disability. I'm on disability now, so I volunteer at the Boomer Esiason Foundation. I'm an advocate. I came from the apparel, the fashion industry. So I was in sales and whatnot, but I have this kind of very creative thing from that world. So where am I now? So here we are. So I began working at the Boomer Esiason Foundation, or volunteering. So I've created Team Boomer, Transplant Grant Scholarships, Podcast Winspins. Here's my logos. Yeah, these are the logos. So all these things, basically what I did is took everything that I've learned in the fashion industry and I took it to the nonprofit world, created all these programs. They're doing well. You cannot fail, just so you're aware where that came from. It's you cannot fail, you are the hero of your own story. It's a mantra that I grew up with, really, with my mom. My dad would chime in also. But my mother was like, don't worry, Jerry, you'll be fine. You're not gonna fail. You'll do well in life and whatnot. So it was just this mantra that I always grew up with. And my mother was like, it doesn't matter, you know, whether you kind of walk or you jog or whatever. It's just that, you know, whatever you do, get up and do something. It's really good for you, positively, mentally, physically, and all of that. So I do a lot of grant writing also at the foundation because I was kind of intrigued with that whole world. I like kind of numbers, and I was a little math geek. So then it's puzzled some of the grant writing. But now I've gotten pretty good at it. So what happened in my progression, I was a runner. I ended up, because I am getting old, I ran marathons and pole vaulting and over 16 feet. My knee, I had 6 arthroscopic knee surgeries, and I would keep going back to the doctor saying, it's still hurting, I think you need to cut out some more meniscus. He goes, Jerry, there's no more meniscus, you're bone on bone. So it got to the point that I needed a partial knee replacement. So I had one done. It was worse than transplant, worse the recovery. So during this process, I thought, well, I can't run anymore. So I created Team Boomer. It was all about running. So I thought, I'm going to put a grant in for biking. I mean, I could bike, but I wasn't a biker. So I put a grant, but before I put the grant in, I touched base with Emily because I knew she got involved in exercise and whatnot. I said, hey, Em, I'm going to put a grant through for biking, like an Indy 500. We'll do 500 miles or something. And I said, do you want to join me? She goes, oh, yeah. I said, I don't think I'm going to get this grant, but if I do, you know, you can come with me. We'll do it together. So what happened is the grants kind of came and went, and it was then like March. Out of the blue, I had 2 pharmaceuticals that responded to the grant request and said, yes, we want to back you up for this program. I was like, oh, my God. I was not happy, really, because I wasn't in shape, and I was like,
you didn't say,
insane.
Oh my God.
So I called up M. So then it was like the process starts. Like once you sign on the dotted line, it all begins. So we started biking. We've done, this is our 7th year.
Is it?
No, 6th. 6th year.
You're the numbers guy.
So yeah, we bike around a lot. We raise a lot of awareness. I don't run anymore. I can't because I had 2 partial knee replacements. But in the interim of all of this prior to that, my lungs got to the point, I was at end stages CF. And I kept arguing with the transplant team, well, I'll exercise a little more. Like, Jerry, you can't hold out much longer. But then it got to the point my lung function had dropped to like 20, 19, 18%. Now, when you drop slowly, you don't think you're that bad. But I remember after my transplant, people said, Jerry, you look like you were dying. And I was like, really? I thought I was okay. I just couldn't breathe well. So I had the transplant. On April 18th, 2012, prior to the transplant, I had 6 dry runs. I got it on my 6th. Talk about emotional roller coaster ride. It was insane. But I was pretty good at this whole process because at the foundation, we gave out transplant grants. So I thought I knew it all. I went to the doctor, yeah, don't worry, I'm all fine. I remember the transplant, when I finally got it, my family was there. I said, okay, guys, just go inside, you know, I'll see you in a few hours. That's kind of how my mind was. And my mother's like, you know, we love you. We're like, yeah, I love you. That's fine. Go inside and whatnot. And it didn't hit me until I went into the operating room. There was like 12 or 13 people in there. I was like, wait a minute. What's going on here? Oh, don't worry, Mr. Cahill. And they put you down. You're out and boom. So, I mean, Here I am today, 7 years later, old with cystic fibrosis. Em is a great friend. We do a lot of great stuff together. You know, I just really believe that it's important in life and to be relentless and kind of live in the forward of possibilities. And I coach. I love my coaching. I coach these kids who keep me young. They teach me about music. That song that you said there where I jumped in the water, that was on my 7th year anniversary. It was freezing. Had my clothes on. But there's a song, Body Body, that the kids made me put in use because I don't know some of these songs. But people say, oh, wow, you're really cool. You know the good songs. They're like, oh, yeah, I know it all. But this year we're going to be biking. You know, I believe in exercising for health, you know, exercise for life. It's important. You know, Em is a great advocate there, too. So it's great to partner up. You know, I'm not the kind of person, growing up, I didn't tell people about CF. It was a secret, not because I didn't want to be treated differently. So for me, a lot of things that I do on Facebook, it's all positive. It's not about, you know, me with CF and all that. It's funny, though, sometimes I will put up something like, oh, I don't feel well. And it's like, wow, I get more likes for that. I'm like, what's wrong with these people? They like it when I'm sick. So, but yeah, I mean, life is good. And I'm 7 years post-transplant. And I have Em here in my life, which is a great friend. And we do things. And what else? Involved, yeah.
When you were talking, I saw a meme today that said, sometimes you feel like a check engine light goes on in your body. And you like, when it's on in your car, you just keep driving, right? But like, if you have a chronic illness, you're just like, oh, my check engine light's on. I'm just going to keep on going. And that's exactly what you just described. I'm going to keep on running like Jerry.
Keep going.
No.
Don't stop. Don't look back
get
either.
Get your tune up. Okay, so we'll talk a little clinical trial action here because they're vitally important, especially now. We got to the part of my life where exercise has made just a huge difference, right? So pulmonary function-wise, exacerbation-wise, instead of 3 or 4 times a year for IVs, it'd be once every 18 months, solely since I started exercising. And then I jumped into the clinical trial for, which we now know as Kalydeco. And this was back in 2009, I think. I did the phase 2 trial, was on placebo. And then I did the phase 3 trial. And I always talk about it in a way where, like, we want you to do this clinical trial. Great. I like clinical trials, especially CF. We got to help each other out because if we don't do it, who's going to do it? Plus, you make a little cheddar on the side. That pays for my running shoes. That's not why I do it. It's not. But when they talked about this trial, they're like, it's going to be a pill, you know, you take it twice a day. I'm like, great, a pill, cool. I was in the zinc study. That worked out great. Pills for CF don't work, right? We're doing breathing treatments. We're inhaling tobramycin and estrianum. We're inhaling these things. Real CF treatments take a lot of time and effort. So phase 2 proved me right because I was on placebo. I'm like, see, you can keep your pills. Those don't do anything. Phase 3 rolls around. I'm like, yeah, I'll do it again. I'll jump in that trial. And 4 days into starting that trial, it just hit me. And it's like someone flipped a switch on the back of my head. And I've talked about this with a few of you guys out there who have been on a modulator. But for me, it was just like night and day. Like, okay, now this is what you've been missing for 27 years. I'm not good at math, but I think that's how old I was. Like, this is a world that you've been missing out on. This is what a deep breath is. This is what not coughing is. And it was like an instant feel of like, wow. And then a few years later, it was, oh, shit. I'm going to be alive. And they told my parents I was going to die. And I lived my life like I was going to die. But now it's like, I'm not going down that road I thought it was going down. What do I do? So it's a little scary, still navigating those roads. Started a retirement fund, which is something I never thought I would need. I got a cool like $3,000 in it, so I'm going to be working a lot longer. I'm never going to retire. Maybe that's my new hashtag, never retire. I bought a house.
One thing I just want to say, the clinical trials are really important. They have extended my life prior to transplant, because a lot of the inhaled antibiotics weren't working. And as you get older, you get very resistant to a lot of the antibiotics. And well, it's now, but it was as Trianem at the time. My doctor put me on that, and I was in a trial, which is Casdin. And that antibiotic extended or prolonged me, you know, staying somewhat healthy before a transplant. So it's really important. And I will tell you, right on the kind of the time when I was getting the transplant, Kalydeco was approved for R117H Delta 508, which is my mutation, but I had a transplant. The thing you should understand is that these drugs are still really important. I'm on Kalydeco right now. The reason I'm on Kalydeco, it's not for my lungs, because my lung function right now is like 105. But, you know, they don't transplant your sinuses and people, you know, the Pseudomonas and everything else, whatnot. And what was happening to me, I was getting a lot of trachea infections 2 years after my transplant. And the doctors were freaking out because they were concerned was, well, it's going to infect my lungs, and then here we go, I'm screwed with my new lungs. So I started taking Kalydeco, which is not clinically proven, but it does, it has the same effect on your sinuses. So my doctors prescribed it for me because I am the mutation. That doesn't mean everybody should be taking it if you had a transplant and whatnot. That's obviously up to your doctors and your medical team. But just being involved in studies and stuff, it's really, really important.
Yeah, especially now. And I think I've discussed with a few people who have recently been on the triple combination study. And, you know, we're talking, and a lot of them had the oh, crap moment I had, because they're like, oh, man, this is not what I was planning for. It's amazing. I feel so good. But how do we navigate this life, which is mental health, which hopefully we'll touch on in a little bit. But, like, filling these trials in the future, I think, are going to be tough because we're – in a few years, when it catches up, a lot of us are going to be too healthy for these trials, which is kind of crazy. Plus, some of them, you need to stop taking your modulator to do a new trial, and who's going to be like, yeah, I'll stop my modulator, I'll stop feeling good. So it's going to be a very interesting time for clinical trials. So we're going to be paying attention and trying to advocate the best we can. Right? Right, Jer?
Oh.
I'm in charge of this thing. Oh, I think it's Q&A.
If you have questions for me, you're going to have to speak up a lot, because I have, because of all of the aminoglucosides, I have a loss of hearing, and I should be wearing my hearing aids, but I don't.
He doesn't wear them on my bike either. That's fun. Jerry, turn left. What? Yeah. I mean, it's fun. It's very fun. I tend to ride in front because it's a lonely road out there when you're riding with somebody who can't hear.
So any questions? Light.
Is that 6 feet?
Is this on? Yes, it is on. Okay, we somehow don't have our mic stand here, and if Jim was up at the podium, he'd be telling you, a volunteer will be at the middle of the room, and because we're live streaming, you must ask your questions from the mic, but please do not touch the mic. A volunteer will sanitize it between questions. But instead, I'm just going to be like Mike Stand. My first name's Mike. Yeah. Last name's Stand. I'll hold. So if people have questions, I just want to say to everybody that I ran the first half marathon of my life last March in Emily's race.
She did it.
So
it was a little bit colder.
It was really cold as a Californian. That was super cold, super early, super dark. But it was great. Yeah. And I don't say that to like get the credit, but rather I have to say it was a singular joy seeing this woman walk around that race. She's like the mayor of Detroit.
That's my next goal. I got a president in the house. Yeah. I know that.
Unbelievable. So great to see her. And I have to say, for me to be running and just thousands of people on this little island and doing this race, and every high school student, I think, in that vicinity was out banging bells and holding signs. It is so incredible. And who knew that I would fly to Detroit to run a half marathon? It was like the best thing ever. Everybody should be there with me next year.
I'll take that.
So, Siri, when are you running the marathon? When's your next one?
You know, I have to say that this experience did make me realize half marathon's kind of my limit. I think 10 miles is the sweet spot. But So I'm going to hold this here for you, for anybody who has questions. And then in a moment, I'm going to get my phone because Travis Flores had a message that he wanted to have read to you. He is in a car on his way here. He had hoped to introduce you guys tonight. So anyway, but I'll find that in a moment. But first, I'll hold them.
Hi, Jerry, this is for you. You were here several years ago, and I picked up a couple of your books that you've published. And I sent them to my great-nephews and my great-niece. And the last time I was visiting, now my daughter, their cousin, has cystic fibrosis. And what I'm trying to do is introduce cystic fibrosis kind of osmotically to them as opposed to a traumatic experience, because they adore their cousin. So he brought me a book to read that night, and it was one of your books. So if anybody gets in touch with you and says, are you her best friend? You say yes, because Jerry, okay. He's one of my best friends. And I read this whole book as though you were my very best friend to my great nephew.
Oh, well, thank you. Thank you very much.
Hi. Okay, so I have two questions, one not very serious, one more serious. So it's the Jerry and M show, JEM show. I'm just wondering, you could have done Jer and and then it could have been Germ.
I like that. Oh, we're open to suggestions.
I'm just wondering why that got voted down.
Germ.
Well, we had a big fight over that. So I said, I want my initial first. And I said, if my initial is first, I'll give you two initials. So she got the JEM, M.
It's a compromise. You got to work with this. My Sonny and Cher.
I was just curious. And then more seriously, I don't know if you two have ever had experience with hemoptysis or I guess just times when you can't exercise, I guess with your transition from running to biking, how you navigated the whole mental health issue where you like want to do your shit, but you can't because it'll kill you. So... Yeah. What strategies you use?
So regarding exercising and mental health, is that?
I'm so sorry, I'm blocking you.
Because I'm deaf.
Exercise is great for your mental health, but if you can't because you're just coughing up a lot of blood or your knees died or something like that, what strategies?
So you know, I just really believe because I don't have knees that can run anymore. The pound, they would kill me. And being sick, I just believe that you just need to keep reinventing yourself in everything that you do in life. I mean, I came, in high school, and I would get sick. I couldn't go to track meets. But the biggest thing in my life is I was up for a huge promotion and take ownership in a company. And I had to, it's like walk into a candy store, and you can't have it because I had to go out on disability to get the transplant. So that kind of, it just rocked my world. I mean, it was like, I thought my life was over. And then on top of it, I was at end stages CF that I had to get a transplant. And there was no other option. I had to reinvent myself. And reinventing myself was then getting involved with the foundation. It's not a job. I treat it like a job. But I volunteer there and I coach and I can't get paid because I'm on disability. There's only a certain amount you can get paid. So even with exercise, I mean, like I said, I went from running to biking because I can't run anymore. And if I can't do certain things, I just go out and walk. But just to be outside and just be involved in the game of life, I think it's really important. And I know having cystic fibrosis can be very depressing for a lot of people, and it's lonely. But, you know, there's so many things where, like Emma was saying, get involved. I mean, there's so many places just to go to a community, in the community services, that you can go out and do something for 3 hours a week, and it's amazing how you will feel mentally for doing that. I mean, don't get me wrong. There's days when I'm working at the foundation and doing these programs that I'm like, I'll even talk to people, and I'll say, well, when I had my real job, because it's not like, you know, like I'm a volunteer. And it's great, and I do great work. But I'm used to a real job when I'm banging away and selling and commissions and that kind of thing. So, you know, it's tough out there. But I think the most important thing is wherever you are in life is just, whether it's with exercise, career, relationships, you just got to try to keep reinventing yourself, if that makes sense.
Yeah. So I had that, I'll touch on that. Just last week, I didn't exercise once, and I'm training for a marathon right now, so I was going berserk. So I was in the hospital, I had to start IV antibiotics, I have a PICC line, and I just didn't feel good enough to run or exercise, and I'm like, I'm going to lose my mind. Like, I am about to lose my mind. So this week, finally, Tuesday, yesterday, and today, I got to run again and get back on my schedule, but I was, like, getting in some dark places. Then I start thinking, like, well, maybe I can't start running. Like, your mind is very powerful, but you just have to, like, it takes effort sometimes to get past a crappy day or a week or a month or a year to get back on track, so I just experienced that last week.
And just one last thing I want to say. I'm really happy that Em is running that marathon, especially because I'm a very competitive person. So the more that she trains for the marathon, the better I'll train on my biking, so I'll be ahead of her.
I'm cross-training, don't worry.
Hello. Hi. Bless you both, because not one of you has coughed the entire time. So what do you attribute that to? And then when you were coughing a lot, how did you manage the exercise if you were just coughing a lot?
So for me, it's Kalydeco. The first year and a half on Kalydeco, I didn't cough like at all. And that goes from coughing nonstop. So running when you have CF is not comical because it's not funny, but it's very interesting because you're running and coughing the whole time, because with every step you're loosening mucus and breathing heavy, so you're coughing and spitting and like leaving a trail so you'll never get lost. That's fine when you're in a new city, but seriously, the first year and a half I did not cough on Kalydeco, and I'm like, what the hell is this stuff? Like, this is amazing. And then over time I still have Pseudomonas, so that would reoccur with coughing. But yeah, I noticed today on my run, today was the first time I ran in almost a year where I didn't cough like the whole time and spit, because the IVs are kicking in and working. And just the baseline that Kalydeco, my new baseline with this drug have been, it's just life-changing. So yeah, coughing and spitting and incontinence issues, ladies. No? Are we going to touch on that this weekend? But that was a huge issue, which now doesn't happen because of Kalydeco. So the medical advancements are just very powerful.
Yeah, and post-transplant, I don't really cough anymore, but I do take, have to take a lot of medications, you know, immune suppression and whatnot. But I think what's important that people don't realize, that, I mean, I look at it, is your lungs are muscles and you need to work them and exercise them. So even post-transplant, you know, my lung function is at 105, not because I sit home and, you know, eat vanilla milkshakes, drink vanilla milkshakes. It's because I still work out hard. And it's a form of therapy, as it is when you have, well, I still have CF, but when you have CF and you're coughing, to me it was the jogging and the running was the best form of airway clearance. Yeah. Okay, and no other questions? Yeah?
Okay, I just wanted to read, this is not from me, but Travis Flores, who's blasting his way up in a car from LA right now, did want me to say, Jerry and Emily are leading examples of how we all should live our lives. Having CF can be very limiting, but Jerry and Emily have shown all of us how we can take control of our destinies. I hope the world continues to watch the incredible leaps of courage these two take, trailblazing for the rest of us. Thank you.
Oh, very nice. speaking about Travis, I just wanted to, this is really for everybody with CF, and I wanted to dedicate something to Travis. But, you know, with cystic fibrosis, we all face fears every day. And, you know, no matter what it is, oh, I got another pulmonary exacerbation, the thought of transplant, you had a transplant, you may need another transplant. And when you hit end stages CF, let me tell you, it's scary to try to keep a positive mental attitude. But I think it's important in life that, you know, that we all need to kind of try to choose love over fear and not let fear get in the way of us moving forward, because fear is paralyzing to people. And even Travis, you know, who I've known for quite a while, I did a podcast before he ever received his first transplant. And he's just a fine young man, and now he's facing his third transplant. So I just wanted to give Travis a shout out. He's not here, but I have a song that I just wanted to dedicate to Travis and actually to everybody. It's a great song. So you can stand up and dance and
dance
shake, or just sit there or whatever, but hit it.
Everyone clapping. No.
Em's quite a dancer, too, so she may just bust it out.
I'm marathon trainer. I got to save my legs. Did your kids teach you this one?
So hopefully Travis is watching this on his drive or can hear it.
Down in the heart or hidden in the stars above. Without it, life is
dancing.
Wasted time.
Come on, guys, stand up. Dance.
Look inside.
Mike, come on, Mike. Mike, give us a dance. Mike from the foundation. There he goes. Go, Mike. Woo!
We walk the line and try to see, falling behind what could be. Bring me a higher love. Bring me a higher love. Bring me a higher love. Where's that higher love? I keep thinking of
a rug over there.
This is a sneak preview for tomorrow night.
Thank you.